overview of the MassCom. Dr. Jacobs.
Thank you, Dr. O'Gara. MassCom was performed against the following background. We know that emergency coronary bypass surgery following PCI has become a rare event, so it raises the question of whether cardiac surgery on site is still necessary for the safe and effective performance of PCI. Moreover, the need for access or timely access to primary PCI has justified the expansion of PCI to hospitals without on-site cardiac surgery. But controversy exists as to whether there should be a further expansion for non-emergency PCI to these hospitals where the risk-benefit ratio may be different and the need for timely access is less important to cardiovascular outcomes. In 2006, in collaboration with the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, MassCom was designed to provide additional evidence for them on which to base regulatory policy decisions about expanding non-emergency PCI to hospitals without cardiac surgery on site. And therefore, the aim of our study was to compare the short-term outcomes and 12-month outcomes of PCI, non-emergency PCI, at hospitals without in comparison to with cardiac surgery on site. The MassCom trial required that patients undergoing diagnostic coronary angiography at hospitals without cardiac surgery on site were randomly assigned in a 3-to-1 ratio stratified for diabetes to have the PCI performed at the site without cardiac surgery or to be transferred to a site with cardiac surgery to have the procedure performed. MassCom was a prospective, multicenter, randomized, controlled non-inferiority trial. The co-primary endpoints were safety at 30 days, a composite endpoint of death, MI, repeat revascularization, and stroke, and effectiveness at 12 months, again, a composite endpoint of death, MI, repeat revascularization, and stroke. The co-primary endpoints were compared for non-inferiority using a relative risk non-inferiority margin of 1.3 and 1.5 respectively at the 30 days and 1.5 and 1.3 respectively at 30 days and 12 months. Hospitals and operators had to have certain requirements for volume prior to participating in MassCom. 3,961 patients were enrolled in the study, of whom 2,774 were randomly assigned to PCI at hospitals without cardiac surgery on site and 917 to hospitals with cardiac surgery on site. And at 30 days, 97% of patients were available for follow-up, and at 12 months, 87% were available. In terms of the results, the primary endpoint or the primary endpoint of safety at 30 days, MACE, major adverse cardiac events, were no different, 9.5 versus 9.4% with a relative risk of 1 and a significant p-value for non-inferiority. Similarly, the co-primary endpoint of effectiveness at 12 months was no different between hospitals, 17.3 versus 17.8%, with a relative risk of 0.98 and a significant p-value for non-inferiority. So in summary, PCI performed at hospitals without cardiac surgery on site was non-inferior to PCI performed with cardiac surgery on site with respect to the 30-day safety and 12-month effectiveness endpoint. And these data suggest that for patients that PCI can be performed at hospitals without cardiac surgery on site, albeit with formal programs and specific volume requirements, and that this could be an acceptable option for patients to presenting to such hospitals for care.
Dr. Jacobs, let me call on Miguel Quinones, whom you know as the chair of the Scientific Sessions 2013. Mike, can we have your comments, please?
Absolutely. First, Alex, this is just a wonderfully well-done study, and you know, it's the kind of study that involves a lot of community hospitals where you basically have people who are practitioners, and I just commend you for how well this was done. As a all-time cardiologist who have been a cardiologist for 40 years, i.e. I started in the days of the boondocks. It's just phenomenal to see the progress we've done in 40 years and a disease that we feared so much to manage and took us so many precautions. Nowadays, it's truly a commodity. I mean, patients go into community hospitals, they can get this done extremely safe. And this is what this study shows, is that certainly in community hospitals where you have people well-trained, this can be done as safe as anywhere else, with an extremely low risk for having to emergently do some surgical procedure. But when you presented it, you still had a few patients that were in that category. So I think one of the questions I have for you is, what preparation would you advise community hospital to have as a team to be able to manage these very infrequent situations so that when they happen, they do know what to do? That's one question. And my second question is, can all hospitals in America pretty much use your selection criteria for high risk, the group that should not be done, or you think each hospital has to kind of learn their own lesson and decide their own high risk group, what it should be?
Well, those are good questions, thank you. There are specific requirements, there were in MassCom, for hospital participation, so that the site really had to be well trained. We trained the staff, the on-site surgery hospitals, the partners trained the staff at our own hospitals, and we give them policies and procedures so that they were very well equipped, and they came and they did cases and watched cases in our labs. So that's important. The volume requirements are also important. You know, the concern is that there'll be a proliferation of low-volume hospitals so that they have to meet volume requirements. And in terms of using the same criteria, MassCom uses specific criteria, but I would refer to our guidelines. So our guidelines also outline the criteria for performance of PCI at hospitals without cardiac surgery on site, and I would recommend those as the global recommendation.
What kind of training did you do to manage the very rare bad complication, because it may happen once a year or once every, so, and when it happens, then are people ready to take on and do what they have to do?
So, again, it was what they saw at the on-site surgery hospitals were, again, these type of complications, which you can't really predict sometimes, a complication. A low-risk patient may have a complication, but they were ready to mobilize and transport the patient. They had intra-aortic balloon capability, and they had ambulances parked outside so that the patient could be quickly transported.
So there is a vehicle pretty much very accessible to
And one of the requirements in this collaboration agreement was that the patient had to arrive at the hospital with cardiac surgery on site within 60 minutes of the decision to transport. Okay, great.
Thank you. Neil, can you provide some comments? Dr. Kleiman, also from Methodist, co-chair of the sessions and also moderated this morning's sessions. Neil?
So first of all, Alice, I'd like to congratulate you guys on a superbly done study that I'm sure took a lot of work. There are wonderful things about this study from a technical clinical trials point of view in terms of using cluster randomization successfully. But I think the major take-home message really has to be on a slide, and I timed it while you were up there. You spent about 40 seconds on it. The critical thing is this was not a haphazard program, not a haphazard decision to order some guiding catheters, see how cheap you can get some stents and guide wires, and then say, hey, let's do it. This was a very rigorously designed program with a long training period for operators, a long training period for hospitalizations, and very clearly defined pathways to manage the patients. So getting set up before this was done took a lot of work and a lot of organization on the part of the participating hospitals. And I think the take-home message really has to be that, yes, you can do this. Yes, you can do it safely if you have learned, A, to select your patients, B, to train your operators, and C, to establish a safe and reliable system for doing all these things, for managing the patients, and for preparing for some of the potential disasters that can occur even in elective patients. And, you know, those complications are very uncommon, but they can have, as Miguel alluded, programmatically disastrous implications. It really changes the whole mood and tenor of a program when something unexpected and disastrous happens in an otherwise healthy patient. So I can't emphasize clearly enough how important it is that every center that undertakes something like this go through all the painful and meticulous steps of getting ready for it.
Thanks very much. Now, let's open it up for questions, please, from the press. And